What's up, guys? This is Michael Kamalu, aka Dr. Gaines, and this is part two of my three-part forearm series. In part one, we did an overview of the posterior compartment of the forearm, which houses the extensors, and then honed in and did a deep dive on the brachioradialis specifically. In this part two, we're going to go over all the rest of the extensors. And as I said in the previous video, the extensors can be thought of as the ones that make up that fan on the back of your forearm. And we're going to go over the ones that are below that brachioradialis on top. I'll start by giving you an exercise I developed that will allow you to hit all the forearm extensors the way that you want to, and then we will go into the anatomy of the forearms to understand why that exercise and that technique is effective, including why, if the only thing you're doing to work your forearm extensors are rollers or some other form of static extension of the wrists, you are leaving a lot of gains on the table. And the anatomy and biomechanics behind all of it is really cool and really important for weightlifters to understand. So make sure you watch through to the end, even if it means you have to come back later and review parts that you missed. Remember, you can always use the key timestamps that I put in video descriptions to skip right to specific parts of the video. But enough of that, let's get to the workout. For this exercise, you'll start by standing a few feet behind and to the side of the cable. And then, while keeping your elbow locked, you'll grip the handle in an overhand position and begin alternating between relaxing your fingers and letting the weight drop down to the ends of your fingertips, and then hyperextending your wrist back while simultaneously extending your fingers back, bringing the weight back and up. Imagine trying to bring the weight up so that it's sitting on the back of your wrist. And while you're doing the finger and wrist extensions, you'll simultaneously be walking slowly back and forth, starting from that position where the origination of the cable is in front of you, walking forward until the cable is directly to your side, and then walking forward even more until the cable is coming from behind you as you do the wrist extensions. And then continue doing the extensions as you walk back. And you want to walk slowly enough that you're getting at least 5 reps of the hyperextensions while walking forward, and 5 as you walk back. When your body is behind the cable, you'll want to emphasize the abduction of the wrist that will naturally happen as a result of the angle of resistance. And when your body is in front of the cable, you'll emphasize the natural adduction of the wrist that will happen at that position, both of which I will explain in more detail here shortly. Now, there is a free weight alternative to this technique for those of you who may not have access to a cable machine. It's just a lot harder to do because it's more difficult to manipulate angles of resistance with free weights, and I haven't had time to record it yet. But it's on my to-do list to record and share a video of in the future, so make sure you're subscribed and turn on those post notifications so that you don't miss it. In the meantime, if you don't have access to a cable machine, this technique does work well with resistance bands. And I will put a link to the specific resistance bands that I would recommend in the video description if you're in that position. Now, let's do a deep dive into the why behind the workout. I mentioned at the beginning of this video that if all you're doing are wrist extensions and static wrist extensions to work the forearm extensors, then you're leaving a lot of gains on the table. And by static, I mean along a single plane with the same resistance angles. And the reason for that is that the forearm extensors are responsible for a lot more than just extension and hyperextension of the wrist. In fact, of the 12 muscles, there's not a single one that only does wrist extension and hyperextension. Many of them don't do wrist extension. Let's start by taking a look at the anatomy of the two extensor muscles that are at the top of that fan, right below the brachioradialis, and that is the extensor carpi radialis longus and extensor carpi radialis brevis. Both of those muscles, like most of the extensors, originate here on the lateral aspect of the distal humerus. It's called the lateral epicondyle. And then they travel down and cross the wrist bones to insert at the base of what are called the metacarpals. And those are the bones that go through the middle of your hand. So they insert right at the bottom, the base of your hand, just across the wrist. So when they contract, they do pull that back of the hand back and do wrist extension and hyperextension. And if you're confused by that, extension is bringing your hand to neutral, hyperextension is bringing your wrist even further. But if you look at those muscles, they don't go straight down, do they? Right? They curve out And then you can really see it at the bottom. They curve back in before they insert on the back of the hand. So because they are already originating on the lateral side of the forearm and then curve in before they insert on the hand, they are pulling this way. They're pulling laterally. And that is called wrist abduction. And that is why in this technique that I showed you, you start behind the cable. Because when you're in that position, when you are extending, hyperextending your wrist, you're also naturally abducting your wrist. Just a matter of your position and the angle between you and the cable. When you pull up, you're also going to be abducting your wrist. And the further back behind the cable you go, the more that will be pronounced. And you can go further back than I demonstrate in the video. But when you're at that position behind the cable in this exercise, try to emphasize that abduction aspect as you are extending and hyperextending your wrist. And you will nail the extensor carpi radialis brevis and longus, along with the other forearm extensors that are also located on that lateral side of the posterior forearm, which includes the abductor pollicis longus, the extensor pollicis longus, and the extensor pollicis brevis. Those three deal with extension and abduction of the thumb, which again, the natural position of you being behind that cable will force you to do, and you can emphasize it even more by focusing on that when you're in that position of the exercise. Now let's take a look at the extensor digitorum, which is generally the second largest of the forearm muscles in the posterior compartment. It also originates up on that lateral epicondyle and then travels down, and it also does have one insertion point on a metacarpal, so it does pull the wrist back and is involved in wrist extension and hyperextension, but that's obviously not all that it does, right? You can see that it expands and then it has insertion points on the middle and distal phalanges of all four fingers, minus your thumb. So it's inserting in the middle and farthest most section of your fingers. And so when it's contracting, it is extending those fingers back. And that is why in this technique, I mentioned it's important that you let the handle drop down to the edges of your fingers. And then when you are extending your wrist, you're also extending your fingers back. And this is an important distinction. You're not just curling your fingers in. Right? That would work the anterior compartment, the flexors. And that's not what we want to do now. We'll get that in part three. You're not just curling your fingers in, you're actually extending them backwards as you hyperextend your wrist. And that action of having the weight at the end of your fingers and focusing on extending your fingers backwards, that is what is going to really nail the extensor digitorum. This is another reason why it's harder to replicate this exercise with free weights, because if you were to try and hold a free weight with the edges of your fingers, it would just fall, right? Because with the cable, you're able to get it coming at an angle, you're able to get that in the edges of your fingertips and get that extension without the weight falling out of your hands. And this technique of using the edges of your fingers and extending your fingers back, it's also going to ensure that you're hitting two of the other extensor forearm muscles, and that is the extensor digiti minimi and the extensor indices. Those two are responsible for extension of the pinky and the index finger, respectively, and they do not have any insertion points on the metacarpals. They go straight to the middle and distal sections of each one of those fingers. So they are not involved in wrist extension at all, right? They are only focused on extension of those fingers, which again is why if you're only doing those forearm rollers or static extensions of the wrist, you're not even hitting those two at all, and only very little on the extensor digitorum. Finally, let's look at the medial side of the forearm extensors. That would be at the bottom of that forearm fan. And there we have the extensor carpi ulnaris. And by the way, with all of these muscles, you can tell what they're going to do by their names, right? So we had the extensor carpi radialis longus. So extensor, it extends, and carpi is because Carpus refers to these bones on your wrist. Carpi means wrist. So extensor carpi extends the wrist. Radialis, it runs along the radius and longus. It's a long muscle. Okay, so on the other side, we have the extensor carpi ulnaris. So it extends the wrist, and it runs along the ulna. But the important thing to note here is that although it is involved in extension and hyperextension of the wrist, that is definitely not traveling straight down. In fact, if you take a look at that insertion point, it is completely out on the farthest side as possible on that metacarpal bone. It is as far medial as you can get. So when it's pulling, it's not pulling straight back, it is pulling in. And that pulling in is called adduction of the wrist. And that's why in this technique, you're walking out until the cable is coming from behind you. Because when you're in that position and you extend your wrist, you're naturally going to have an aspect of adduction to that motion. And the angle of the cable at that point is actually going to provide resistance against adduction. Just like when you're behind it, there is actually resistance against that abduction movement. When you're in front of it, there is resistance against that adduction. And so, again, you can improve that by just focusing on adding that aspect of adduction to what you're already going to naturally get in that position and nail extensor carpi ulnaris. And since the forearm extensors are so complex and there are so many different angles going on, it's not exact, right? And that's why we don't only work them from those three different positions, from behind to the side and in front, but you are doing those wrist motions throughout the whole time as you're walking back and forth, making sure you're hitting those extensors in as many different angles as possible, making sure you're getting a full, complete workout on all of those forearm extensors. Guys, if you thought this video was valuable, I'd appreciate you hitting that like button and leaving me a comment, as those things will help YouTube recommend my content to others. And if you haven't yet, be sure to add your name to the beta tester waitlist for my Maximum Gains Series forearm program that is in development. I will leave the link to that in the top right of the screen. And just for adding your name to that list, you will get 50% off when it's available to beta test. And as always, if you have any specific content requests or feedback, you can find that link in the video description below. Mahalo, my friends. Until next time.